The Creative Process with Vince Ornato. Vince is a professional Pittsburgh artist that works in many mediums. And now Vince is going to share his creative process with you.
Hi everybody, this is Vince Ornato again. I'm going to do a little demonstration lecture today about painting on location. This is a painting I did about a month ago when these white leaves come out at the very, very beginning of, I think it was very late March, beginning of April. There's a row of trees near where I live. And I went out and did this piece here. Sort of like first day of spring, maybe not technically, but visually. This is a study I did last summer up on Polish Hill, looking down. There's a church up there, and I apologize, I forget the name of it, but I did this from Polish Hill. It's a study looking towards the Strip District from above, and it's just another on-location piece I want to show you. Again, it's with a rough board, a tone, and you know, rough texture, and it's meant to do in an hour or so, and this is one from last year. What I've decided, there's a grassy area here in the park and a few trees, and there's a driveway in the background, and that's what my composition's gonna be today. One of the things I wanna talk about, this is a very, very rough canvas because it's actually a board. It's similar to Masonite. It's sort of a wooden clapboard, but I gessoed it with a very thick texture, and I'll get into more that type of thing in other shows, how do you gesso stuff and so on. You can actually buy these in art stores. They're a very clean, smooth surface gesso. They're already pre-done for you, and I used those for a lot of years. Now notice also, this is a warm color, and that's what I'm going to use today, and I'll explain why in a minute. This is a cool-toned color, as you can see. You know, warm, cool, and it's something to think about a lot while you're painting. Don't always think as much as green and blue and red and so on as you do is warm and cool. The other thing about the tone, it's not real vibrant. It's not, you might call it dull even. It's not a real bright, bright red or a bright, bright purple. But that's so that you kind of have a neutral that you're working with on your tone. So those are a couple of the elements that are going to come into play today. The scene that I'm painting has a bulk of cool colors in it. And I usually use the opposite tone of the dominant warm or cool in the painting, in the scene. There's a lot of greens, trees and so on, bluish greens, and those are cool colors. There's a gray driveway in this. So because of that, I'm using the warm. And what that does, if you use the opposite behind it, it charges the color up a little bit better for you. You see here, what I did, I had an 8x10 mat, and I cut it to make two L's, okay, obviously. So what this does for the artist is you can much more easily determine your composition when you look through the, we'll call it a viewfinder. It's like a homemade viewfinder. I used to measure all this out with math and everything, and then it just dawned on me one day, all I need to do is hold it up against my canvas to get the right proportion, and then I can look over at my subject to determine what I want to do. Now, one thing about that, don't be overly rigid with this. It's just a guide. It's just a help. You can drive yourself crazy thinking about all these kind of technical things, and you start being kind of held hostage to them. You can overdo it that way. It's just a guide. You want to be loose and free. That's one of the reasons I'm standing when I paint. It's a much more active and healthier position as opposed to sitting down. Now you see how large this palette is down here. This is what I have in my studio. I brought it out today because I knew I'd be talking, and you know, it's just a little easier for me to deal with this show today using this. And this is what I used to bring out all the time when I painted, and I did it for years, and it's actually very nice to work with while you're painting on location because you have such a lot of room. I put the same colors in the same spot on the palette, and I learned a lot about that with Daniel Green, and I think most artists do it. It's sort of like keys on a piano. You're setting them up in the same position. Imagine if a B and a C and a, you know, G sharp were in different places every time you went down to play piano. It'd be impossible. So the more you can keep the colors in the same spot, the easier it is for the flow and all. On the palette, I'm going to be mixing and placing the colors where on the palette where they actually go in general in the painting. I picked up that tip in The Art Spirit by Robert Henry. It's a very, very famous art book. But if you place the colors on-site painting on the palette, where they actually go in the composition, it's much like the piano keys situation, you can get a much better flow going. I tend to have warm brushes and cool brushes. That's the way I divide up in my mind again. That's like we were saying earlier about that. I'm going to begin by laying out my paint. And when I do it, it's funny because you can kind of look at the palette at some point and it looks like it's actually a painting. So I'm going to do that now, and then it's like all set up. My piano keys are all set up, and then I can start drawing and then just go into it from there. So, okay, I'm going to do that right now. I should add, too, one of the real benefits of painting on location for all the people that only copy photos, which I use photos, that's another lecture, but when you paint on site, you really see the wide variety of nature. It's almost mind-blowing, the variety of colors. If you think of a rainbow, we think there's these seven colors, but if you keep looking at it, you see that those initial stripes you think you see are really gradual tones, one leading into the other, and there's literally hundreds and hundreds of tones and colors in a rainbow. So what I'm going to do now is start the drawing. I'm going to use a little bit of regular turpentine just to make the paint a little more liquid and begin. It's important to understand I'm not making a trees. I'm giving you the illusion of trees. This is not exact. This is not a tree I'm making. It's a painting of a tree. So I don't have to get hung up on every little perfect detail, hence the impression, you know, the impression of what I'm doing here. Thank you.
Visit the Oliver Miller Homestead, an 18th century reenactment site located just off the circle on Corrigan Drive in South Park. Self-guided tours are available each Sunday from May 1st until December 8th from 1:30 until 4:30 p.m. with guides in 18th century garb located around the grounds to answer questions and to give information. Your tour will begin in a reproduction bank barn where displays give information on the movement west. You will also see the Miller Still and learn about the production of whiskey and the importance of it and of the whiskey rebellion to this area. Follow the Miller Trail up the path and visit the transportation shed, demonstration shed, forge, a reproduction log house, the original spring house, gardens, and finally end at the stone house. Each month, the guides host at least one special event. The homestead is also a great place for tours, tailored to the needs of school-age children, scout groups, or adults. Visit our website at www.olivermillerhomestead.org for a schedule for the year and much more information on the history of the Miller family, our organization, and pricing information.
I've shown an interest in making home movies. Me and some buddies would just grab a camera and just start making these videos. And then you realize at some point that this isn't just a hobby anymore. It's something that you actually want to pursue. And there's this great facility right down the road, BPTV. A lot of people will try to do these productions on their own. And one of the things they don't have is the equipment, you know. But right here is everything that you need in one nice little bundle. There's lights, cameras, reflectors, dollies, all kinds of little knickknacks, like anything that you'd want to use that you would need for a production, you have it right here. Like, it's all right here. You can make your own feature movie just with the stuff from this studio. Come meet Dave Cable, let him show you around, and I think you'll realize that this is something that you could fall into regardless of your level of expertise, whether you're a beginner or even if you're a more advanced learner. There's something here for everyone, and I feel that you just need to come through and just be a part of the experience and just watch and learn, and you know, let Dave be your guide.
A lot of the process of this is something I want you to focus on more than like some of the technical artistic side of it. Notice how I'm holding the brush. Do not hold it like a pen. You're really painting with your body, as I said. You're not painting with your hand per se, you're painting with your body. Okay, let's get I got some of the dark shadows on the ground there. Now, it was Federico Fellini, the famous Italian director, said, I'm a liar, but I'm an honest one. The grass part, actually, compositionally, on the bottom of this painting, it should be in shadow, but I'm going to lie and make it the very bottom. That comes later, because that brightness will pop forward if I make it in the sunlight. That'll pop forward, causing a foreground, and push everything behind it as in a background. So like Fellini, I'm a liar, but I'm an honest one, because that'll make for a better painting. So I have a warm toned canvas, 8x10, with a very rough surface on purpose. And right now at this point, it's really just two colors, raw umber and green. And I'm going to make a red note for the first time in that far background. Now I'm painting red on red and it's coming out purple, that's why. You know, it's a reddish color with some blue in it, just a very, very, very little bit of blue. It's looking purplish. There are some shadows on that red, and again, I'm painting the darks. So that's my note for now. One of the things that happens when you paint, everybody, including me, we always want to run to the light. Boy, oh boy, don't we? But you can't get ahead of yourself. The reason is that is you want strong tones all through, mid-tones. The darks are easy to see. Once you get into the mid-tone area, boy, we all want to rush it. You know, we all want to get going and get to the light. And that's a problem. And that's part of the discipline of this. You got to be careful, because if you do it too early, you don't have strong enough foundation in mid-tones to hold everything together. If you look at the painting now, I would say, maybe 50% of the canvas, but it's a board. 50% of it is filled, 50% of it is empty. And you can almost, looking at it now, because the value of the board, the light quality of it, the value is dark and light quality of any color, is pretty much lighter than everything on there. So that'll give you an idea of where I'm heading right away, even though the color is wrong. You know, the color's the tone of the canvas. So I've laid in my darks. I'm starting to head towards some mid-tones. And I began with the darkest dark in the painting. So I'm starting to head towards the mid-tones, and I'm dying to get to the light, which is what, like I said, we always want to do. But you can't rush it because you want to have a nice foundation. Okay, I am actually going to get a different brush out, because that whitish green is so different than the yellowish green. That it calls for a different brush. This is really strange to me. The grass area was clearly a yellow green for most of the time. Now it's, because there's a little bit of cloud filter, it's starting to look like that whitish green, and I'm going to have to make a decision. So what I've decided, the further away the grass is in the sunlight, that's going to be a whitish green. The closer it is, it's going to be a yellower green. And again, I'm not saying that's right or wrong, but that's what I've decided. I think for this painting, it'll make it a better painting. And that's a good time to point out what I'm saying about on location. Even a photograph is a lie. A photograph is a bunch of ink on a piece of paper, just like a painting is a bunch of pigment on a pulp. You know, it's not really a photo, it's not really a car, it's a photo of a car, it's an illusion. So, you know, much like everybody, when I started out with this, I thought you were actually supposed to, the better you can make it look precisely like the subject, that's the better the painting. That's not necessarily true. Because what is the subject? You know, the sunlight's constantly moving. Clouds are coming and going. All artists that work on site will tell you about the big truck that pulls up and parks right in front of your subject when you're halfway into the painting. So what is the subject really? Well, this scene triggered something in my mind. That's what I'm painting. I'm going to put in that this foreground area, the yellow, the cadmium yellow sunlight, which I've been dying to do. Yay, I get to do it. And it'll give you an idea. See, that's even too dark. So I'm really going to go for it. Thank you.
I brought out a show on the radio about 5 or 6 years ago to try to share a lot of the information that I run across on a weekly basis with clients, and to share those experiences and the knowledge gained from other people's either mistakes or the correct decisions they've made and their successes, and to try to share that with the community so more people could benefit. So we came over and met Dave, and it was real easy. He said, there you go, are you ready? We're very lucky to have this and the resources over here, where it would be quite expensive to try to produce a show like this elsewhere. Bethel Park TV is offering it to all of us. I hope this grows a lot, and I hope a lot more people do take advantage of this. You're missing out on a marvelous opportunity if you don't. It's really a free gift for you to be able to share yourself and your experiences and what your value is with others at low to no risk. Anyone who's considering doing a show, come on out of your shell. Come on over here. Dave's very gentle, very nice. He'll help guide you through this. If you make mistakes, he'll edit it out and record it over, so don't worry about saying something wrong. Just come over and share what you have with others. Just be yourself, come over here and let other people see who you are, why you're here, and who you're trying to help and what you're trying to say. It is that easy.
For those of you in Bethel Park that don't know me, I am Mr. Bold, one of the many stars here at Bethel Park TV, Channel 7. I hope that the folks in Bethel Park understand what we have here in the way of BPTV, the asset that the television station, the public television station, is to the community of Bethel Park. For Mr. Bold personally, one of the things that I would like to do, and I've talked to Dave about this, is a show gearing itself towards veterans. And I would throw out an invitation to the veterans in our audience here in Bethel Park or around the South Hills. If you want to contact Dave Cable here at the station and let them know that you would be willing to share your experiences, especially the World War II veterans who are losing here at an alarming rate, and pretty soon there's not going to be many of them left. I would love to get them on TV if they would be willing and interview them.
What happened when I get back in the studio, I'm often I guess I'll say impressed. These pieces often turn out better than I thought they were, because by the time I'm done with it, I've looked at it so much that it's hard for me to be objective, and the sense of satisfaction often happens later. One of the things you think, like kind of like a mosaic, that's sort of what I did here. This is back to my umber color, and I'm going to be closing in on that driveway. So this is kind of, believe it or not, this whole painting has been leading up to this area here. It's kind of weird to think of that, because it's a small portion of the painting. It calls for the ruler. Where it is, okay. Now, for the first time, I'm stepping back. Usually, I will have stepped back more. As I do that, and one of the things I do, I turn them upside down a lot to see. Okay. I got to just darken a couple values and that'll be it for the day. When I turned it upside down, there didn't seem to be enough dark areas in the painting based on what I'm looking at in nature. One last stroke and I am finished for today's demo. And this is what I did today for the demonstration. And like I said, I will be taking it back in the studio, take a little bit of a break, clear my head, and make some finishing touches on it. And thanks for watching.